In the ninth lecture, we will discuss section 1.3.3, the fundamental theorem for gradients. Before this, in section 1.3.2, there is a fundamental theorem of calculus. So we will discuss that fundamental theorem of calculus, which is also called the evaluation theorem. We will discuss inside this section. So this is a very fundamental theorem in this series. Means first we will discuss the one for gradients, then we will discuss the one for divergence, and then the fundamental theorem for curl. So this is a triangle, and now we will start with this one. We know the relation between the integration and the differential, or the derivative and antiderivative, that if we are having a function and that function is, let's say, a scalar function t, and it is the differential of this function, then this is equal to t, and then the function means the, let's say it's a function of x, so it will be t of x plus some constant of integration, because this is an indefinite integral, and we will have to determine this constant of integration from the boundary conditions or as per geometry of our problem. In the case we are having a definite integral, for example, let's say it is starting from a to b and then dt, then this will be equal to the value of t at b minus the value of t at a, because the integral, it will come out to be t, and then the limits will be from a to b, and we will determine the value of t at both of those limits. Now this theorem tells us, the evaluation theorem, that if, for example, we are having a function, let's say we are having a function, and let's say, let me write that function here, that integral from a to b means it's a definite integral, and then there is a function f of x and dx. And if we know that this f of x is such that this f of x is already a derivative of a function df over dx, means here we are having a capital F and here we are having a small f. Now in this situation, this integral will be equal, means if I put df over dx, then dx gone with dx and df remains, so it will be f of b minus f of a. So this is f of b minus f of a, and this is called the fundamental theorem of calculus, or the fundamental theorem. We have the evaluation theorem, and it tells us, it guarantees that any integrable function has an antiderivative. Whatever function we do, it is integrable, then it is antiderivative as well. And that thing, let me write an example for this one. Let's say we are having limits 1 to 3, and here I am having a function 1 over x, and I will have to integrate this dx. Now I know that here this our f of x, or f of x here is 1 over x, and I know that this f of x is a derivative, means if I write df over dx, then df over dx is actually equal to the differential of log of x, means log of x here. So I can write that this one is equal, this is equal to, means I can write this one is 1 to 3, and then differential of means the f I will write is log of x, and now this thing is then equal to the differential is gone with the integral and log of x from 1 to 3. And now I can put the limits log of 3 minus log of 1, and then by utilizing the relation that log m minus log n is equal to log m over n, so this will become 3 over 1. It means that this is equal to log 3, and log 3 is approximately 1.1. So this way, if I write that this is our f of x, capital F of x, such that this f of x is a derivative of another function, which is small f, which is log x here, then I can write like this. So this actually tells us that it is independent of the path which has been followed from here to here. Now graphically we can understand this one from the definition of derivative. Like if we are having x on this axis and f of x on this one, then I can write, let's say this is our function, and the function is like this. Now on x-axis, if this is value a, then this a corresponds to the function here, which corresponds to the y-axis, means f of a. And if we are having a value b here, then this corresponds to the function on x-axis here and on y-axis here. This is f of b here. Now what we are having here, we are having here f of b minus f of a, means this value and this value, means this value subtracted from this value, so it means we are having this difference. So we are just measuring this difference. The one thing is that we go and cover this, means the integral means area under the curve. So either way we go and cover this much area, then this is exactly equal. If we subtract from this value, and the result will be the same. And this we can extend for the fundamental theorem of the fundamental theorem for gradients. Now I can write, means the dt I have written, the dt I have written, I can write this dt is gradient of t dot dl. It's a scalar function, so I can write it like this. And now what does this mean? Like gradient, we know that this is equal to curly by curly x and x plus curly by curly y and y and plus curly by curly z and k. While dl, this is the fractional length element, this is dx and x unit vector plus dy and y unit vector and dz and z unit vector. Now what about the dot product of them? So the dot product is actually the inner components multiplication. So I can write the gradient of t, which will be, means I will write t here, and dot dl, this will be equal to curly t by curly x dx plus curly t by curly y and dy plus curly t by curly z dz here. And I know that this value is actually the differential of t from the definition. So I have written dt in that form, and now I will come back to this equation, and this equation tells me that integral from a to b, and this is dt, is equal. I know that what is dt, and it is a to b, and dt is gradient of t dot dl, and this is equal, this integral is equal to t value at b minus the t value at a, and this is the fundamental theorem for gradients. Keep in mind that it's a path integral, and this side, which is the left side, the left side is telling us it's a path integral. It depends on the path, because on each and every moment we are finding the inner product between the variation, the spatial variation in t with the length element. So if this is means at any point the inner product between this one, while the right side of this equation is telling us that the result is just the final value subtraction, means the subtraction between the final value and the initial value, and it is completely independent of the path. What path we have followed, it is not depending on that one. So this is telling us that we are converting the path dependence into the path independence. And I can further say about this thing that let's say we are measuring the height of a building or something, or a mountain, or in your book the example of an Eiffel Tower is given. So let's say we are measuring the height of this. Now let's say it's a building and we are measuring the height of it. So the left side of this equation is telling us that there are stairs to the top of the building, and what is the step size of this stair, and if it is deviating from the direction in which the length element is, then we will have to take the inner product and so on. So step by step we will be counting the variation in t with the length element, and we will reach the value, like for example this is A point and this is B point. So we will find the height of this building. The other way is that if we are having a measuring tape and we just stretch it from this to this point, which is point A here, then we will measure the height of this building. So it is completely independent of the path. So this side telling us that we are measuring the things in increment, we are doing the area under the curve here, that how much you can say the differential is adding up and finally giving us the total integrand, and then we are measuring this thing by just with the help of a tape from the first value to the last value. Maybe the stairs may follow another path to reach here or another path, but this will be just counting for that one, because this is the differential length in the variation in the function. And here we can measure the right side is telling us that you can do all that effort very easily by just measuring the difference between these two points. And then there are two corollaries with this one, and the corollaries are that this integral that we have written, this integral that we have written here from a to b, del dot dl, this is a path integral and this is dependent on the path we see here, but the other side is telling us that it is the result is completely independent of the path. So we say although it's a path integral, but it is independent of the path from a to b. And the corollary 2 is saying that if we are having a close path integral and gradient of t dot dl, then this is equal to 0. What does it mean? Close path means that from point from where we started, we reach that path back. Like the integral limits are not from a to b, but from a to a, or from b to b. So in that situation, this value which we are having here, which is tb minus ta, so it will be ta minus ta, and of course this will be equal to 0. So around a closed path we will be coming back to our original position, and this will give us the result equal